So, first of all, I would like to thank Barbara and Claude to invite me for this very nice workshop. What I will try to do today, I will continue to show you some rocks. I am a pure petrologist from my background. I will try to share with you my view on mantle metasomatism after 20 years of study of mantle zonulus. First, I will start with the definition I use for mantle metasomatism. For me, it's the physical and chemical processes that are implemented during the flow of magmas and fluid within the upper mantle. It's a very general definition. The main changes affecting the mantle wall rocks, peridotite, are changes in texture, rock crystallization, formation of new minerals, and chemical exchanges leading to the enrichment, rarely depletion, of mantle peridotite in incompatible trace elements, such as the rare earth element, but also some elements like the niobium, tantalum, zirconium, hafnium, barium. And in my mind, flow is a general, is both pervasive at grain boundaries and focused in dikes or veins. It's a very large definition. I will start with my experience of metasomatism of the phanerozoic mantle. if you are focusing on mantle zonulus, you will find the zonulus for the phanerozoic mantle mostly in alkaline basalt and rolatel lavas, and you will find mostly spinel peridotite. It's by far the most common type of peridotite in this alkaline basalt, and with the typical mineralogy, olivine, tupiroxene, and spinel. You have some example of outcrop here in Kerguelen. Here you have a nice spinel Harzburgite from Papua New Guinea. So first, metasomatism in asthenospheric upwelling zone, such as plume zone, rifting zone, but asthenospheric windows also. What we can see under the microscope is some mineralogical changes. And in general, the main common metasomatic mineral in this kind of peridotite are amphibole, pargasite, and mica, a phlogopite. You can find here disseminated or in big veins, such as in this dunite from Kerguelen, but also you can find the mica here in a dunite, in a spinel dunite. But we have also some new clinopyroxene, pure metasomatic clinopyroxene. What we can see also is some chemical changes. Just one example with the major element, with a series of peridotite from Oman, Kerguelen, Cameroon, and Patagonia. And in this, everywhere you can find this kind of evolution in the diagram showing the chromium against the sodium in clinopyroxene. You have a systematic evolution of increasing chromium and sodium in all the series of peridotite. And this kind of evolution, you can't explain this evolution by partial melting, you only explain by metasomatism. We can find also some changes in trace elements. Don't be afraid of this kind of spectacular patterns. It's a pattern we use for trace elements in the mantle zonulus study. What I will show you today is only, you know, in Cameroon, here it's Kerguelen, Oman, you have the same kind of pattern. This pattern can be explained only by metasomatism. But you know, you have the same kind of pattern in a lot of localities all over the world with this kind of metasomatism. When you are lucky, you have also some other kind of xenolith in your collection. Here in Kerguelen, we have also some pyroxenite. These pyroxenites are alkaline mantle cumulates. And we have also some megacrist, big crystal of pyroxene in alkaline lava. We are sure that these megacrysts are derived directly from the alkaline lava, and these pyroxenites are alkaline also cumulates. So you can see that we have the same pattern, but we have a direct evidence that the metasomatic agent in the mantle beneath Kerguelen was an alkaline melt. Now I jump to the metasomatism in zone of plate convergence, where you have deshydratation and sometimes melting of slab. And we can see, by the study of some xenolith collections, the effect on the mantle wedge. What we can see, from a metasomatic point of view, is a very different metasomatic assemblage where the dominant mineral is orthopyroxene. Here you have some example of vein in the Leer Island near Papua New Guinea. You can find the same here in Japan. And you have also here in Patagonia some new orthopyroxene, strong winding clinopyroxene and olivine. These are magmatic orthopyroxene. We have also in this context some chemical changes. Just an illustration with a diagram aluminium versus calcium in orthopyroxene. And we can see that in the same xenolith, we have two populations of orthopyroxene. The what I call the normal here, primary orthopyroxene, the typical mantle orthopyroxene. And here, the metasomatic one, and you can see that we have a big change in composition for calcium and aluminium. We have also some twice element on this orthopyroxene and associated clinopyroxene is this orthopyroxene-rich vein. You can see some, for example, I don't want to go too much in detail, but we can see the typical niobium tantalum anomaly and the zirconium and titanium anomaly. We have also an effect on the peridotitic of host rocks of this vein. Here you have, I just want to show you this one. I'm sorry for the quality of the slide, but what is very important is here we have the typical pattern for a peridotite coming from a partial metic event, but you can see that for the lanthanum, you start to increase your lanthanum. This is the effect of the vein, the orthopyroxene-rich vein. You have a two-story for this peridotite, first event of partial melting here, with depletion in light fourth element, and enrichment, secondary enrichment, due to the metasomatism. So, in the phanerozoic mantle, what I think is we have two main metasomatic agents, in a very broad sense, in a large sense, in context of asthenospheric uplift, mostly intraplaque settings, we have, as a metasomatic agent, the melt and associated fluid going through the mantle, we have dominantly mafic alkaline and high alkaline silicated melt, more or less rich in CO2. And in some localities, we have also some carbonatitic melt, iron titanium rich basalt, tolitic, ultramafic melt, but the dominant agent for me is this one. And in context of subduction, what is the main metasomatic agent is the hydrated liquid or fluids, commonly rich in SiO2, and links to the deshydratation processes of the slab. So, if I want to resume the main changes we have in the peridotite in these two contexts, for the asthenospheric upswelling zone, you have change in mineralogy of your peridotite with new phases crystallizing, mostly mica, amphibole, and clinopyroxene, and you have a large range of other minerals, such as rutile, apatite, ilmenite. For the chemical changes, for the major element, the clinopyroxene, typical mantle clinopyroxene, is commonly enriched in chromium and sodium, sometimes also in sodium, but also in sodium and titanium in some other cases. For the trace element, the uranium-thorium ratio is variable, but commonly is inferior to 1, it's less than 1. For the amphibole and phlogopite, they are commonly niobium and tantalum rich. For the mantle wedge zone, the main mineralogical change is the crystallization of new orthopyroxene with a lot of amphibole and minor clinopyroxene, olivine, mica, spinel, and some sulfide and magnetite. For the chemical changes, the main are in orthopyroxene and clinopyroxene. We have new pyroxene. They are very poor in aluminium, and poorer than the clinopyroxene and orthopyroxene occurring before the metasomatic event in the peridotite. You have a phlogopite, but low in titanium, and you have some amphibole. They are less sodic and the same MG number than the one from this zone. For the trace element, the uranium-thorium ratio is high. The amphibole and phlogopite are low in niobium and tantalum. So maybe I am a little bit quick, no? So if I now go to the Precambrian mantle with a focus on the Archean mantle from South Africa, where I did some study with colleagues from Cape Town University, what we did is we have studied some xenoliths from the Cap Val Craton, from four localities, Bullefontaine, Jagerfontein, Monastery, and Premier. What we have in the cratonic area, the main carrier of xenoliths are kimberlite, the two types of kimberlite. Sometimes you have also lamproite, but in the Cap Val it's mostly kimberlite. And what we find in kimberlite, it's mostly garnet peridotite. Remember, for the young mantle, what we find in alkaline basalt is mostly spinel peridotite. Here it's garnet peridotite. So we selected some sample, some coarse grain sample with garnet here and olivine, and some high temperature sheet sample. But we also studied some very special lithology, what we call phlogopite-rich rocks. There are the marid types, marid for mica, amphibole, rutile, ilmenite, and diopside, and the peak for phlogopite, ilmenite, and clinopyroxene. And to be brief, this kind of rocks are, in a broad sense, cumulates from the two types of kimberlite. But what we find is we find in our garnet lherzolite two types of garnet lherzolite based essentially on the trace element composition of clinopyroxene. Here you have the clinopyroxene for one group here, and for the second one here. And we did a comparison with the clinopyroxene we have in this kind of cumulative rocks from kimberlite, here for the marid, here for the picked, and we have a good comparison between the two types of clinopyroxene from the lherzolite and this peak and marid clinopyroxene. And what we know also about this marid and picked, they have the same isotopic composition, the simple isotopic composition of strontium against isotopic composition of neodym. You can see that the picked fall within the field of type 1 kimberlite and the marid within the field of type 2 kimberlite. So what we show is that we have a genetic link between picked rocks and group 1 kimberlite and between marid rocks and group 2 kimberlite. And this genetic relationship between the two type mantle metasomatic genetic relationship between the two mantle metasomatic agents affecting garnet lherzolite from the Cap Val Craton and the two types of kimberlitic magma. So this kind of metasomatism can lead to important modification of the cratonic upper mantle and in linked with the circulation of kimberlitic melt. And you know that the kimberlite are very, most of them are very young in Cap Val. The more recent are around 65 million years old. It's a little bit older for the type 2. But what we found also in the Cap Val Craton, we have some evidence that we have an over some kind of metasomatic event, an older one if you compare to the kimberlitic metasomatic event. Here I show you a diagram for wall rock, peridotitic wall rocks, and with the magnesium, the Mg number, it's Mg ratio is Mg, Mg plus iron ratio, and here the Mg plus Fe versus silica ratio. And you can see here that a lot of the phanerozoic xenoliths follow the normal partial mating trend, but here a lot of samples from the Cap Val, from the Cap Val cratonic mantle, they don't follow this melting trend. They follow a trend that evidence some addition of silica. And with DEV, we go back to samples from Cap Val, and what we found is we found some sample with some, it's not very easy to see here, some orthopyroxene-rich vein. in the cratonic mantle of the cap wall. Here you have the typical garnet lherzolite wall rock, and here you have one opaque-ish vein. So what I think it's, even in the Archean mantle, we have also two main types of metasomatic agent, what I call the high alkaline melt. It's linked to kimberlite, orangeite as the other name for the type 2 kimberlite, and associated fluids, CO2, water, and also the differentiate from this melt. And these melts are known to be linked to astenospheric upwellings in this kind of settings. We have also a second main type of metasomatic agent, intermediate to SEOH silicate melt and associated fluid, and differentiate probably mostly linked to suprasubduction zone. So my conclusion from Mantoux Xenolith study, from my experience, is even if there is a lot of different kinds of chemical and mineral changes associated to mantle metasomatism, we may propose two main large types of mantle metasomatism, both for old Archean and young mantle. Some astenospheric upwellings related metasomatism, mostly linked to the associated magmatic event leading at the end of the uplift of the xenolith by alkaline and chematic lavas, such as lamproite, but also lamproite and orangeite, sorry. And the second main one is a subduction-related metasomatism. It could be seen directly without any later imprints of the previous type if xenolith were uplift by calc-alkaline lavas. But this situation is very rare. We have, for example, the situation of the Kamchatka, where we have calc-alkaline lavas with mantle xenolith inside. But more often, you have to be lucky and find the good sample within a lot of samples showing evidences of the first type if your collection was uplift by alkaline lavas or by kimberlitic lavas in cratonic area. These processes of mantle enrichment by metasomatism could have commonly affected the upper mantle and more than one time through the upper mantle history, making difficult to decipher that history. Even more complicated, this history is even more complicated if you add mantle depletion processes, such as a partial melting. So what I mean, it's very difficult to study the natural sample, the mantle xenolith, especially the xenolith from mantle, because you don't know the number of events that your mantle went through. I mean, one, two metasomatic events, one, two, several partial melting events. This kind of metasomatic processes imply changes in petrological, mineralogical, and chemical characteristics of the upper mantle, and therefore imply changes in the physical properties of your upper mantle, density, porosity. We know that it's more easy for a melt to circulate inside a dunite, where you have more than 90% of olivine, than in a lherzolite, where you have pyroxene and sometimes garnet. Anisotropy also. Finally, when pieces of the upper mantle are recycled by, for example, delamination processes within the convective mantle, they imply changes in the composition of this convective mantle. And to finish, I would like to thank Dave Bell. He gave me this last slide, because we try with Dave to replace the metasomatism, especially for the cap wall, in a large frame to predict the consequences of mantle upwelling beneath a continental lithosphere. So, if you have emplacement of hot mantle, for example, beneath a cratonic lithosphere, you will have transient thermal pulse, leading to transient density decrease and a transient uplift. But also, you have thermal erosion of the lithosphere, for example, by a plume, elevation of the geotherm, permanent the density decrease, and permanent uplift. But you can also, if you emplace hot mantle, melting, melt migration, melt rod reaction. Here, you have the metasomatic of the lithosphere. You can have a link with the transient thermal pulse, a link with the evolution of geotherm because you add some radiogenic rich mineral in your mantle, such as phlogopite or amphibole. You can have, depending on the type of your metasomatism, for example, if you add garnet, you will have a permanent density increase. If you dissolve your garnet on your pyroxene to form dunite, you will have a permanent density decrease linked to the metasomatism. You have also plume chemical anomaly leading to permanent density increase and leading to subsidence. I think it's finished, leading to delimination. Thanks for your attention.